And listen as our choir sings, I've got that old-time religion.
Amen.
Take your hymnals once again, please. Page number 437. 437, stand and let's sing Send the Light. Page number 437, and please stand with us. Sing that first.
There's a call comes ringing o'er the restless wave. Send the light, send the light. Souls to rescue, there are souls to save. Send the light, send the light, send the light. The blessed gospel light, let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine forevermore.
As the instruments play through that a time or two, get around and shake hands with your neighbor. Sing that second verse.
We have heard the mass of the thank you. sing out last. Let us not grow weary in the work of love. Send the light, send the light. Let us gather jewels for a crown above. Send the light, send the light, send the light. The blessed gospel light, let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine.
Thank you. Please be seated. And now we have Jan to come sing for you.
Blood still cleanses hearts of sin. It still delivers fallen man. It has never lost its power to save. No, the blood hasn't ever changed. You may search for answers in this ever-changing world, solutions to the problems that you face. But I am here to tell you, you can't find the answers here, 'cause they're only found in God's amazing grace. 'Cause the blood still cleanses hearts of sin. It still delivers fallen man. It has never lost its power to save. No, the blood hasn't ever changed. Critics don't believe that the blood of Jesus heals. They say there's nothing to the Word of God. But there will come a day when even they shall kneel to the King of Kings. Praise God, it won't be long. 'Cause the blood still cleanses hearts of sin. It still delivers fallen man. It has never lost its power to save. No, the blood hasn't ever changed. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. It has never lost its power to save. No, the blood hasn't ever changed. No, the blood hasn't ever changed. Hasn't ever changed.
Amen. Amen. That's a good song. Amen. Good to know in a world where you can't trust anything that the leadership tells you.
That's right.
They're going to change every day. You got a book in your hand that's never going to change. They can try to change it, but man, that old word, that blood of God, that blood of Christ, it's good. Well, welcome to the AM service this week. First off, good to see Larry Owens here with us today.
Amen.
Recovering from surgery. Great to see you over your seat, and he's still there, don't worry. This isn't really anything new. He'll be up. We do have a sad note out of the Smith family. David Rader, who we prayed for, who pastored over at Brea Baptist for years. David went home to be with the Lord this week. He was on a flight home from visiting with his family, and he went to sleep, and that was it. Woke up in eternity. So he's home with Christ, and we can be thankful for that, but certainly the separation period is tough on the family. So if you'd be in prayer for the Rader family and, of course, the Smith extended family. Aunt Colleen is his mom, and that's Pastor Smith's sister, and she's been here with us before. So if you'd pray for her, it's a heartbreak to have to put one of your kids to rest. So let's pray for her. Of course, Sonny Medina, that I don't think we saw him this morning, so keep Sonny in prayer if you would. Announcements, we moved track distribution from yesterday to next week on account of the rain that didn't arrive, so we got that going for us. And Fifth Sunday Sing later this month, so put that on your calendars, that'll be our evening service. And I think Super Bowl is the week after, AFC Championship is the week before.
Who are the Patriots going to be playing?
Well, we might be able to move Fifth Sunday Sing to the 7th, right? It's a bye week. Anyways, January 31st, Fifth Sunday Sing, 1:30, that'll be the PM service that week. Gentlemen, if you come forward, take the Sunday morning offering. Track of the week.
Anybody interested in about a $25 Valentine's banquet?
I don't know if this is rhetorical. Is anybody interested in about a $25 Valentine's banquet coming up, I guess, mid-February? Are we looking for a raise of hands? What are we doing here?
Yeah, anything like that.
Any interest?
Any interest? Amen.
I guess pending childcare, maybe?
Right.
Okay, we got one couple.
Two,
three, four, five, six, seven, eight. 9, 10, 11, 12, Dennis is coming stag, 13, I got about 13 couples.
13 couples?
I love you too, Dennis. About 13 couples, I guess, at first count.
And we could have it on the 6th or 7th. You'll be out of town maybe on your anniversary.
I think the 7th is the Super Bowl. So that wouldn't be, it's also church day.
Yeah, we'd have it on a Friday or Saturday.
So 5th or 6th, roughly?
Maybe, if we skip
or the week time. Or the week after?
If we go the week before, when Steve would be in town.
14. About 14 couples. Okay.
Before the 14th.
About 14 couples.
Oh, about 14 couples. My knee, man.
The knee was operated on. These are just 70. Okay, so I guess more to come here.
Good.
We'll be talking again.
I got it.
All right. Track of the week, we've got a one-year Bible reading plan. That's out there. That might be good to pass on. That might be good to put in your pocket.
Amen.
So it goes month by month and day by day, it looks like. And you've got a family set up for some devotional and some private Bible reading for yourself, so that's good. Pick that up if you would, and find somebody that's interested in Bible reading and hand that off to as well. All right, let's ask the Lord's blessing on today's... Oh! Birthdays. Gentlemen, sit, please. We've got Brother Elizaris. He's got a birthday today back there. Happy birthday, Brother Elizaris. And... And Mr. Jacob Christian, who I don't see over there, but the family is here. Wish him a happy birthday for us, if you would. Brother Galloway?
Let's sing happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. God bless you. Happy birthday.
In case you don't know, when you're standing up here doing this, there's a lot of things running through your head. So I get a little more appreciation for Dad when he brings the guys down front and tells them to sit down again and then covers five other things. So as far as Dad goes, he's here, he's doing well, he's looking good, he's tired. So we're helping out, pitching in, doing things like announcements here and trying to not embarrass Dennis too many times. But we're good to have Dad here. Keep praying for him. Get some strength back if you could, and ask the Lord's blessing on him. So gentlemen, if you'd stand, ask the blessing on the offering today. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, so much for meeting with us today. Thank you, God, for the ability to be here this morning. God, for you giving us strength to get here, and God, enough burden to want to be here. God, to be under the preaching and the fellowship with other believers. We pray, God, that you take this offering, bless it, and multiply it according to your use. Thank you for all of your blessings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much, ladies. Take your hymnals once again, please. Turn to page 47. Stand with us. Jesus, Lord, to me. Page 47. Please stand with us. Jesus, Lord. You're dismissed. Sing that once again. Seated.
I have heard once a bird has a broken wing, it will never fly high anymore. But let me tell you what I know, that's not always so. For once I lay helpless and sore. Fell from above like a wounded dove, with no hope of ever climbing again. But with grace from above and God's marvelous love, I'm flying higher than I've ever been. Higher than I've ever been. Higher yesterday's sea, where eagles can't soar, I can see heaven's door. I'm flying higher than I've ever been. Yes, I fell by the way, life's wounded prey. Then old Satan, like a vulture, he swept low. And in my darkest hour, that's when he came to devour what was left of my old wretched, my dying soul, as low as life gets. But God was not finished yet. He'd seen more hope than I ever saw in me. Now I live above the doubts, so high in the clouds that I can't see the tops of the trees. Higher than I've ever been. Higher than yesterday's sea, where eagles can't soar, I can see heaven's door. I'm flying higher than I've ever been. Where eagles can't soar, I can see heaven's door. I'm flying higher than I've ever been.
Well, W.E. Dowell was preaching there in the chapel one day, and Mr. Music of the Fellowship, Earl Smith, sang. Dowell got up and said, "Well, the old war horse has still got it." I can't really call Mike the old war horse since he's younger than me. But it does remind me. Great job, Mike and Jan and choir. Thank you very much. Good to see each of you. Thank you for being here. If you have your Bibles, would you turn to Exodus chapter 14, please? Exodus chapter 14. Verse 12. I will add my condolences to the passing of Dave Rader, over 25 years over there at Brea Baptist, and great impact on the community. A citizen of the year there in Brea, I believe. And, just knew everybody in town, and everybody there respected him greatly. So our condolences to the family, every part of the family. He did his best to serve God, and did it for a long time, and pretty good sense of humor. Great pulpit speaker, I thought, and always interesting to listen to. I remember one day he said, gas prices has gone up, and he said, my wife wanted to go out someplace to expensive, so I took her to the gas station. So he he could always come up with a great one-liner, I thought, and had a great pulpit presence. He'll certainly be missed. Exodus 14:12. Is not this the word of the Lord that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians? And it goes on to say, for it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness. Father, we thank you for this part of the scripture. And God, as we look to it, might you speak to our hearts, we pray. God, thank you that we can be here. What a blessing just to be in God's house here today. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If I may exercise the privilege of paraphrase, and I certainly would call it paraphrase, and not in any way indicating that I'm writing a new version, amen. What happened here is kind of, see, I told you this was going to happen. Somebody says to Moses, see, I told you this was going to happen. Didn't I try to tell you to leave me alone? Why didn't you just leave me alone like I said? Now let's get a little more context, this is my paraphrase. Exodus chapter 14, verse 10. And when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them, and they were sore afraid. And the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord, and they said unto Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, hast thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Wherefore hast thou dealt thus with us to carry us forth out of Egypt? Is not this the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians? For it had been better for us. By the way, what's the key word in Hebrews? Better. We got a better covenant. We got a whole better life, don't we? In Christ. What are they saying? For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness. Okay. They're afraid. I guess that's somewhat understandable. I mean, the whole Egyptian army is coming after them. What they don't realize is God's brought them literally between a rock and a hard place. They think, well, we got them camped in between Pi-Hahiroth or whatever it was, and let's go get them. They're trapped. What happened? God entrapped the Egyptians. That's what was happening. But that's another story. So they were afraid. Now, evidently, they've forgotten all about the miracles that God took care of in Egypt. Now, how does that happen so quickly? Huh? Is there a message here for us? You know, we've seen, that's a song of God's grace that Mike just sang. And we've experienced that. If we're saved, we've experienced that grace of God. Amen? Amen. Well, these Israelites, miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle. I mean, I would say unbelievable miracles, but they're believable. And they saw them all. And now here comes Pharaoh, and they figure, hey, we are without hope. They have evidently forgotten the miracles. They cry to the Lord, and then they criticize Moses, who did nothing more than what God told him to do. They cry out to the Lord, and what do? They pick some poor sap that's a human being that's doing what God told him to do, and God put him in a position of leadership, and they jump all over him. Must be a lesson there for you. Okay? And they've taken the opposite of our American patriots. Didn't Patrick Henry say, give me liberty or give me death? Yeah. These guys are now taking the opposite. They've invoked the essence of the latter-day cliche, better red than dead. Yeah. Let me tell you something, better dead than red.
Amen.
They got it wrong. In this case, would have been this. Better west of the Red Sea and oppressed by Egypt. Okay? Better west of the Red Sea and oppressed by Egypt than dead under the Red Sea while chased by Egypt. That's how they're looking at it. They say, we're goners. We'd have been better off just staying back in Egypt. Yeah, they didn't treat us very well. Okay, but we were all right. Remember the leeks and the melons, and we ate pretty good back there. Now, boy, isn't it funny how you can look back on a terrible time when you're in dire straits and all of a sudden think you had it good? they did not have it good. And despite all the moaning at the outset of their journey, as usual, Moses had the answers. I want you to see what Moses had for answers. Verse 13. Number one, your fears are unfounded. Now, we ought to remember that. Now, look, I don't want to demean being burned at the stake, and I have no desire to be a martyr. Matter of fact, keep me in prayer. I don't want what the doctors keep reminding me is going to happen to me if they don't take care of the infection. Okay? So I'll take the rapture before that. So I'm not a martyr. Okay? I don't really like pain. I like feeling good. Okay? I'm not happy when I don't. But we need to remember that our fears are unfounded. I know we're all going to die. Okay? What a shock. I got a real shock. He died. Is that really a shock? The when might be a shock, but the what is not. And we've taken care of that, haven't we? And so how do we take care of it? Well, Christ took care of it. Amen? He gave us the Bible. He gave us the gospel. We put our trust in him. That is taken care of. Moses says, your fears are unfounded. Look at verse 13. Moses said unto the people, fear not. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show to you today. For the Egyptians whom ye have seen today, ye shall see them again no more forever. Number one rule in life. Buzz, what's the number one rule in life? There it is. Even Jerry knew that. Fear not. Number one rule in life, don't panic. Number two, stand still. Verse 13. I think General Patton said, never pay for the same ground twice. Never pay for the same ground twice. Stand still. Don't give up what you already have. Bob Jones said, don't sacrifice the permanent on the altar of the immediate. Okay, here come the Egyptians. Look, don't panic. Stand still. Hang on. God's not done. Don't retreat. Don't sacrifice a permanent on the ultimate of the immediate. And sometimes we have to employ James 1:4. Let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. Sometimes we have got to be patient. And then he says, all right, stand still, fear not, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Now, often, I could say usually, your salvation lies in the future. You say, have you been saved? Yeah. Well, I can't say this on tape here, but a guy came in and preached one day that you hadn't been redeemed. Now, the Bible is pretty obvious that what hasn't been redeemed is your body. It says, to wit, the redemption of the body. These bodies have not been redeemed. We're not walking around a glorified body. Okay? This is a corruptible body. But we have been redeemed. So, well, how so, preacher? It's in the future. Isn't our salvation in the future? I'm not in heaven. I'm not in the sweet by and by. I'm in the nasty now and now. Amen? Isn't that right? You got bills to pay. You got ailments. You got this. You got that. You got problems next week. You got homework. You've got whatever it is. It's not all easy. We're looking to the future for our salvation. It's a guarantee, but it's still future. We need to understand that. Often your salvation, usually your salvation lies in the future. Now, promises have been made. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So what you're talking about with faith is things hoped for and things not seen. Your faith is things hoped for and things not seen. I've seen heaven through the Bible, but I've never been to heaven. Paul got caught up to heaven. I haven't been. We take it according to the Word of God. Say, what's your substance? It's the Bible. What's your evidence? My evidence is my faith that I get from the Word of God and from the Holy Ghost. So we look at this thing and say, all right, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. We need to understand that's the nature of the business we're in. It's not what you can grasp physically. It's what you grasp by faith. And that is your substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. The Bible says in Hebrews regarding Moses, by faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. We haven't seen God. We gather together because we know God is real. And how much of our faith, let's just admit it, how much of our faith, and we can say faith by definition is invisible, it's not seen. It's something hoped for, if you will, or trusted for, and it's to come. Amen? So what does Moses say? He said, look, don't fear. Stand still. Stick with it. Don't let something rock your boat. And see the salvation of the Lord. You don't see it right now, but it's coming. And it's coming soon. And you know what else he said? He said, by the way, you won't be seeing these guys anymore, ever. Amen. He said, these guys chasing you, you're not going to see them again. Yeah. How can such a thing be? How can such a promise be true? Well, he's going to part the Red Sea. He's going to let you walk across it. They're going to come after. He's going to bring the Red Sea. And in the morning, they'll see the bodies floating on the shore. How about that? Moses said unto the people, fear not. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show, future tense, to you today. For the Egyptians whom you have seen today, you shall see them again no more forever. Satan bugs us. One of these days he won't. Amen. We'll never see him again. And by the way, you do your part. You fear not, you stand still, and you see the salvation of the Lord, and he'll do the heavy lifting. Amen? Exodus 14:14 says, the Lord shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace. How about that? How about just shutting up and see the salvation of the Lord? Oh, that's a novel approach. Amen? Let God do it. Let God work. Just trust him. You keep quiet and watch. But you can't do that while you're running away. Look at verse 15. And the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel that they go forward. But lift up thy rod and stretch out thine hand over the sea and divide it. And the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea. And I, behold, I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians, and they shall follow them. And I will get me honor upon Pharaoh and upon all his hosts, upon his chariots and upon his horsemen. He will take care of it. Stop whining. Get going with the ambush. And one more thing. Verse 19. And the angel of God, which went before the camp of Israel, removed and went behind them. And the pillar of the cloud went from before their face and stood behind them. And it came between the camp of the Egyptians and the camp of Israel. And it was a cloud and darkness to them. But it gave light by night to these, so that the one came not near the other all the night. God was leading the charge. The presence of the Lord went from before to behind. He was darkness to the lost world. He was a bright light to the saved world, and on they went. Now, were the Israelites right in verses 10 through 12 to say, let us alone that we may serve the Egyptians? Was that the right thing to say? Moses, why don't you just leave us alone so we can stay in the world and serve them? Are we really afraid to trust the Lord, to believe that he'll fight against those devils who are drowning our baby boys in the river and enslaving our daughters? Don't come and tell me how good the world is, all right? Amen. Don't waste your breath telling me that. I know what the world does. They kill babies. That's one thing they do. They corrupt your kids every chance they get. Okay? Don't tell me how good it is in Egypt. It's not. It's good in God's camp. It's not good back there. I was in Egypt for 26 years, I guess it was. And let me tell you something. I don't want to go back. Amen. Amen? I like where I am. Amen. How about you? Amen. It's a great thing to be saved. Amen. It's a great thing to have God on our side. Amen. And that stinking world can stay right where it is. Not live. Thank God that somebody didn't leave me alone. I know Scott talks sometimes about Kevin Jackson. And Kevin Jackson under threat of bodily harm from a very strong man kept witnessing to him. Yeah. He's here today, saved on his way to heaven, humanly speaking, because of Kevin Jackson. Amen. And thank God he didn't leave him in Egypt. Yeah, amen. Amen? Amen? Can't we all say the same? Yeah. J.O. Grooms came in and sat down beside me, and man, whatever Buddy said, he'd open his little red Bible and put it in my lap. Man, he stayed with me. I was walking out of that place, so I came more often than the deacons did, but I wasn't saved. Buddy said, it's about time, isn't it? I said, yeah, I'll probably talk to you tonight if I'm here. He said, wait a minute, Jerry. Wait a minute. With me, either you're coming or you're not. I said, okay, I'll be here. J.O. Groom says, well, preacher, maybe he's ready to get saved right now. He says, no, J.O., I know Maine people. When they're ready, they're ready. When they're not, they're not. So I went home lost, hoping I didn't have a car accident. Because Buddy said so. Came back that night and got saved before I talked to Buddy. I knew I need to be saved. And thank God I was. Egypt is no good. Egypt is a pile of garbage. Don't ever say to Moses, hey, why didn't you leave us alone in Egypt? What about your kids and your grandkids? What about your friends? What are you going to tell them about the future? Thank God we got the Bible. Stand still. Amen? Don't be afraid. Stand still and just take a look. God's about to move. He's done that in our lives. He'll do it again. Do you really want to whine and cry and say, leave me alone so I can serve the God of this world? It was better when I was in the world. Was it really? Listen, he's promised. God, I don't want to be left alone. I want your presence and your leadership. Moses again had it right. Look at Exodus 33, if you will. Exodus 33. Bible says there in verse 12. Exodus 33, verse 12. And Moses said unto the Lord, see, thou sayest unto me, bring up this people, and thou hast not let me know whom thou wilt send with me. Yet thou hast said, I know thee by name, and thou hast also found grace in thy sight. Now therefore I pray thee, Moses says to God, if I found grace in thy sight, show me now thy way. I think of John 14, where Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Amen? No man cometh unto the Father but by me. We know the way, it's Jesus. But he said, show me now thy way, that I may know thee, that I may find grace in thy sight, and consider that this nation is thy people. And he said, God said to Moses, my presence shall go with thee. My presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest. And he, Moses, said unto him, God, if thy presence go not with me, carry us not up hence. God, we don't want to go anywhere without your presence. Now, that's what Moses said. Moses was some kind of guy. He wasn't perfect. He lost his temper now and then, like some of us other great leaders do. Listen, what is it with you? What is it with you today? Is it God, leave me alone? God, I'm supposed to go to church, man, and pass the plate. Supposed to raise my kids to serve God? Is that you saying, God, leave me alone? Kids want to be in the world. I want to be in the world. I want Egypt. Leave me alone. I had it good before I got saved. Now there's all this pressure on me. Is that you? Or is it, God, I'm going your way no matter what. I'm with you. That's the way I want to go. Please, God, don't you ever leave me alone. I want your presence. I love your presence. And without your presence, I'm not taking a step. Which is it with you? It starts with receiving Christ as Lord and Savior. If you're here today and you haven't done that, you probably don't understand what I'm talking about. When you put your trust in Christ, you get God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost indwelling in you, His presence in you. And if you want Him to, He'll lead you. Be not drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit. Man, oh man, we get saved, we get all the Holy Ghost we're ever going to have. We got to make sure He's got all of us. We need to give ourselves over to the filling of the Holy Spirit, and He'll lead us. His presence is with us. When you receive Christ, you have that. From then on, it's what kind of attitude you're going to have. You're going to be like those idiotic Israelites. They're killing their baby boys, enslaving their daughters, wasting them, abusing them. And the minute they get in trouble, they say, Moses, why didn't you leave us alone and leave us in Egypt? What are you talking about? Are you crazy? Have you looked in the Bible to see what you've got? Have you looked to the future and know you're going to heaven? Have you looked at your precious little children and said, man, just put your trust in Christ and you'll be okay forever? And your grandchildren? And you want to go back to Egypt? You want to say, leave me alone? Thank God that Moses didn't leave him alone. He could have. God actually gave him that opportunity later. Moses wouldn't do it. God knew Moses was right. Was he testing Moses? I don't know. We've got to get a theologian in here someday to teach us all this stuff. Amen? I know this. Moses was a great guy. And what about us? Leave us alone? Or no, God, if your presence doesn't go with me, I'm not going anywhere. This is where I stay. Wherever God is, that's where I stay. Amen? If you haven't received Christ, you need to come. We got an invitation coming. You need to come and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior, be born again. You walk out of here guaranteed you're going to heaven. He'll part the Red Sea for you. You'll go across and He'll kill everybody that follows you. Amen? That's where you'll be. Guaranteed. Satan's going to the lake of fire. The beast is going to the lake of fire. False prophet's going to the lake of fire. You'll get there. You got it made. You're going to heaven. You put your trust in Christ. And after that, just ask yourself, where am I? Am I, leave me alone, God, I want to go back to Egypt? Or am I, hey, without your presence, God, I go nowhere. Brother Mike, if you've come.